Once again, I'm going to be talking about extension methods this week, but not the generality of the rules of how we write them and that sort of thing, but specifically some of the extension methods that we have on IEnumerable, because although they can be very useful, they also can lead you into certain pitfalls to do with performance that really can have quite a big impact. So let's have a look at what we're talking about. And so here I've just got a function that takes as a parameter an IEnumerable of int. And if we take a look at the functions that are available, well, we should know that the only method we've really got on there is getEnumerator. And then the methods on getEnumerator, we've got our current to look at the current element, reset to take it back to the beginning, and then move next, which will move us on to the next element until we reach the end. And if you're not familiar with that, there's a link to a video that goes into that in a bit more detail. But although that's what we've got on IEnumerable, we also have a number of extension methods for IEnumerable. And so if we simply add in a using directive to include system.link, then when we have a look at ints, we see it's got far more methods available as extension methods. And the two that I wanted to look at, although there are others that will behave similarly, but the two I wanted to look at are count, which will give us the number of elements in the collection, and also ElementAt, which will give us a specific element, a bit like you'd get with indexing to an array or something like that. So that gives us the 10th element in this collection. So let's take a look at that in some real examples. And so what I've got here is the very widely used list. So I've got a list of ints, and then another standard collection, but certainly rather less commonly used, which is a linked list of ints. So I've created both of those. Then in the constructor, I just populate them with 10,000 elements each. We're not worrying about the time it takes to populate. But then I've got a number of benchmarks. And what I do is on each of the list and the linked list, I just go through all of the elements, I add them up to give us some kind of result, but I do it using these extension methods. And we can have a look at the list, and with the list, it's not strictly necessary, because the list actually built in has a count property, and a list built in has an indexer. So we could have done this directly, but just to keep things consistent, I'm doing it with the count and the element at extension methods. And then the same thing for the linked list, which in this case, although it does have a count directly available as a property, it does not have an indexer or anything like that. So we can see there that we don't get the indexer available. So we do it with a for loop that goes up to the count and uses the element at. And then we do the same thing in what is probably a better way to go, which we've got a for each, both on the list and on the linked list. And that doesn't require any of these extension methods. That just uses those basic features of an IEnumerable with the enumerator and move next and that sort of thing. So I've got those as benchmarks, and I've got the baseline as the for each on the list. And so in the program, we'll just put that in, and then we will run this, and that'll take forever. So we'll leap ahead and look at the results. And if we take a look at those, we see that we've got our for each on the list is the fastest one. So that's our baseline with one. And a for each on a linked list is quite a lot slower, about 5 times as slow. Well, that's okay. We'll see why that may be when we look at the details. The for loop with the list is even slower. So clearly on a list, it's better to do a for each than a for. But then fantastically slow, so 34,000 times slower than the for each on the list, and still whatever a fifth of that is on the linked list, doing the for loop on the linked list is just horribly slow, ridiculously slow. Why is that happening? Well, we've got to understand the internal structures of both of these types of collection. Starting with the list, internally, a list allocates an array of ints in this case that it thinks is going to be big enough for what's going to be stored. That array starts off as empty, and then when you add things into the list, then the array just gets filled up until it reaches the end, in which case the list internally will allocate a bigger array, copy over the original data, and then carry on inserting from that point. And so although you get an occasional overhead when it has to do this reallocation and copy, overall, putting things on the end is a pretty fast operation. The way that a linked list works is that each individual element is at its own location in memory, And the ordering of the list is put together by the fact that each element is wrapped in a linked list node, and that has a reference to the next element in the list, and then to the next element, and then to the next element, and so forth. And then also in a linked list, this one happens to be a bi-directional linked list, so you also get those references going in the reverse direction as well. And what that means is that with a linked list, you've never allocated more spaces in it than you need. And the really big advantage of a linked list is if you want to insert a new element in the middle of it or at the beginning of it, then all you have to do is disconnect the references there, put your new element somewhere in memory, reconnect the references with that new element in there, and you've not had to really move anything around. Whereas if you think back on the list, if you want to insert in the middle or at the beginning of a list, then you've got to move up all of the elements ahead of it, which could be a large amount of memory you've got to copy around. So adding onto the end of a list is fast, but adding in the middle of a list is not very fast. So that's the difference between inserting. But the really big advantage of a list is it has random access. That's why it's got the square brackets indexer, which basically means if you want the 500th element, you just start at the beginning, you offset by 500 times the size of the int, and you're at the 500th element. Whereas if you want to do that on a linked list, you start at the beginning and you count through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the way up to 500. Much, much slower. Fine for sequential access when you're going through from the beginning to the end, but if you want to jump to the middle, it's not particularly fast. And that's the problem that we're getting here. Because when we use those extension methods, if the extension method ElementAt, for example, is done on something that does have random access, does have the square brackets operator, it makes use of it. But if it's done on something like the linked list that doesn't, then it just does that counting through, which is so inefficient. And actually, we can see how all that's working with this list that I've written here. So here, I've got just a my list, generic for T, and all it's doing is wrapping up an actual list. So nothing new in terms of that, but it's implementing IEnumerable, and all I'm doing is exposing the getEnumerator, but I've also written a special counting enumerator, which again is just wrapped around a regular enumerator, so we set that up. The point is, whenever we do a move next, we increment this move count. We've got the move count and the total move count, so move count is just the number of times move next has been called on this enumerator, whereas total move count is static, so that's going to be the number of times it's being called on enumerators all the way through. And so that's what we've got in the my list, so it's just exposing that list, but only through the limited methods of IEnumerable. And so if we go back to main, and let's create one of these my lists, so var my list equals new my list of int, and then let's pop into that just values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. And so, simple enough. And then let's just use this the correct way with an IEnumerable. So let's have a foreach var item in my list, write out the item, and then at the end of all that, I'm going to print out the counting enumerator and get hold of that static total move count. So we'll write that out as well, and we can see what's happening. So the dispose for that will print out the local move count, and then I'll print out the overall move count. And if we do that, what we'll see is, as we'd expect, that to iterate through 10 items, move count has been called 11 times, because for the 10, and it's got to move one more to discover that it's reached the end. So that's as efficient as you're going to be in dealing with this collection. But if I do that the wrong way, so if I say for, and then int I equals 0, I is less than my list dot count, so there we're using the extension method, plus plus I, and then I'm going to have console write of my list dot element at, so that's using that other extension method. So that's what the benchmark was giving us trouble with. And if we run that, we can see it's just ridiculous how many times it's calling move next. It calls it 11 times, then it calls it once. So each one of these reports is generating a different enumerator, calling getEnumerator a different time. And you can see it calls it 11 times then once, then 11 times then twice, then 11 times then three times, and so on and so forth, until it gets all the way through and there's a total of 176 calls. And that's obviously going to be quite slow. We can break that down, actually, because if I comment that out, so if we just have the loop without doing the element at and run that, we can now see it's just called 11 times, 11 times. And the reason for that is what this count has to do, because we're only exposing the IEnumerable part of this, it has to start at the beginning and call move next until it reaches the end and literally count the number of elements. It doesn't know the number of elements, it counts the number of elements, and it does that on every iteration of the for loop. So that's why you've got 11 times 11, 121. And that is obviously a performance problem. So what we do is, to get around that, go back to my list, and then as well as implementing IEnumerable for T, we can also implement ICollection for T. And if we implement that, and it says implement it through list, so it'll generate lots of code for us. But basically, what it will do, it has a few things. It's got a contains and a clear and a copy to and a remove. But the main thing it does is it gives us this count property. And that simply calls the count property on the list, because the list, remember, does know its count. A list doesn't have to step through to do these things. So now we've got that. And so in the program, even though we're still using the count extension method, when we run this one, we get zero calls to the getEnumerator. Because what the count extension method does is it looks at the class and tries to see if it can convert it to an iCollection. And if it can convert it to an iCollection, then it calls the count directly, and therefore we get this efficient count that doesn't need to step through. But if it doesn't find an iCollection, then it does it in the laborious way of just stepping through each one. So even if we had the count property, because we don't have the interface, it's going through in that very slow way. So part of the problem, probably not the hugest part of the problem, is actually that it was not having that iCollection. And in fact, if we look at the linked list, LinkList does actually implement iCollection, so the count part of that was quite efficient. It was just going on to the direct count property. But then if we go back into program, we've solved the count problem, but we still have the element at problem. So count is now not causing us to call move next at all. But if we run it, we're still getting the idea that it's called once, then it's called twice, then it's called three times, then it's called four times, and again, really slowing things down. And again, that was the problem that we had with our linked list, because what it has to do each time we say element at, when you say element at one, it just has to step through one step, but then it goes back to the beginning for element two, step through two steps, goes back to the beginning, steps through three steps, goes back to the beginning, steps through four steps, and so in total, we get the 55 steps there. And again, the problem there is similar to the one with iCollection, because what we need to do on my list to get the random access, we also have another interface called IList for T. And if we, again, let it just automatically implement that through the list that we've got in there, then, again, it adds all sorts of other bits and pieces. But the key thing of interest to us is it has an indexer, and so you can see that indexer is now referencing the indexer of the underlying list. And now if we run that, we can see we don't get any calls to move next at all, because the same sort of thing happens. When we say element at, it has a look to see if the collection supports iList, and if it does support iList, then it will use the indexer directly. If it doesn't support iList, then it has to go through the long-winded way, which is why we get all those calls. And when we have a look at our linked list does implement iCollection, so a linked list does know its own count, but it doesn't support iList, so it doesn't have any true random access. And so that's why it was so slow, certainly on 10,000 of them, because it was having to count through every time, in just the same way my list was if it didn't have the IList interface implemented. So it's really something you've got to be very careful of. If you have an IEnumerable, so if you have, like we had back here, where you've got a method taking an IEnumerable, treat it like an IEnumerable. Only use those features of it that are supported by IEnumerable, which is basically it's got a getEnumerator and you can loop through it. When it comes to the extension methods, well, not all of them are bad. Things like sum is not going to be inefficient on something that doesn't support IList and things like that. But certainly the count and the ElementAt are going to be horribly inefficient if the actual collection you've passed in there doesn't support ICollection for the count and IList for the ElementAt. And it can cause really horrible performance issues. So just the thing to be careful on that. Some of those extension methods really can be troublesome. Still though, hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.